Let's show the first 80 Stones record. This one is Undercover. This one is... This one is... Hi everyone, it's James here. Welcome to another video, and today I am once again joined by Richard McCook. Hello, Richard.
How are you doing, James?
Yeah, not too bad, thank you. And thank you for joining me for this particular video. This is something which Richard and I have had up our sleeve for a while. We're going to be talking about the Rolling Stones in the 1980s. And yes, this is a topic which occurred to me a while ago, and Richard seemed like a likely candidate to share it with me. So the Stones in the 80s, Richard, is it something which appeals to you? Is it a favourite era for you?
I tend to go back to it quite a bit. I wouldn't say it's my favourite era, but I find that the album's quite easy to listen to and not quite as sanitised as the material from the 90s onwards. Okay, the 80s for me, nothing compared to the classic early 70s albums. Mm-hmm. But I lived through these 80s albums. I bought three of them in real time. So that's why I keep going back to them. So I enjoy them.
Yeah, I mean, my perspective is a bit different because I didn't listen to the Stones until maybe the mid 90s. You know, I did a video with John Downing a while back, Queen in the 80s. And I think the 80s were an interesting decade for a lot of these big bands, these bands that have been around since the 60s. You know, some of these bands managed to survive, some of them managed to transform and, you know, do something spectacular. Others, of course, faded away. Queen had a very good 1980s, at least from a commercial point of view. And we'll get into the Stones, you know, on that theme. But just as a quick kind of start, how would you compare, say, the Queen's 80s to the Rolling Stones 80s? Do you think there's a comparable?
I would actually say that the Stones 80s albums are not dated, bar one.
Okay.
What I will say is that Mick Jagger released an album in 85, which I don't know how much of that was going to be a Stones album, but that is riddled with 80s production. Mm-hmm. So I think they stuck to their guns, and obviously then Jagger, whenever he's doing his own stuff, he was more contemporary sounding. But one album is a little bit dated. In fact, there's only a couple of songs off that are quite dated. Mm-hmm. But the problem with the Stones is the quality of the songwriting isn't quite as high in the 80s as it was in the 70s. And yeah, it's a little bit samey at times.
So let's show the first 80 Stones record. This one is Emotional Rescue, and this is the first Stones album of the 80s. Now, there is a bit of a backstory to this. I mean, this could go on all day. I mean, the Stones had a fairly spectacular 1970s in a way, but there were lots of things happening to them. You had the whole Keith Richards drug addiction thing, mm-hmm. which sort of, I think it had spiraled out of control really towards the back end of the 1970s. Famously, he had the drug bust in Canada and it looked like he was going to go to jail. Emotional Rescue took a long time to record, actually. I got the dates here. It came out on the 20th of June, 1980. Mm-hmm. They started recording it at the beginning of 1979. An awful lot of stuff was going on. Keith Richards' marriage was breaking up. And of course, you had this thing with Mick and Keith where they were kind of tied together at the hip. They weren't really like Lennon and McCartney had been, because Lennon and McCartney were kind of individual songwriters who were capable of doing their own stuff, whereas Mick and Keith were tied together. Yeah. It was almost like a marriage, wasn't it, really? There are a couple of issues. One of the issues is quite an interesting one, is as Keith gradually came out of his drug fog, although it actually took him a few years, but he started to realise how much he'd taken his eye off the ball. Mick Jagger had taken control over the business empire of the Stones, and he was intent on turning the Stones into a true showbiz entertainment juggernaut, you know. And really what's interesting about the Stones in the 80s, that it starts the story of the Stones turning into this thing that we know today, really, which is just this non-stop juggernaut, incredible showbiz empire. It's really in the 80s that the seeds of that are sown, because Mick Jagger has decided he's going to get his business head on and he's going to really take control of it. And as Keith gradually emerges from his heroin fog, he doesn't take kindly to this idea that Mick has now seized the reins. So that's the basic dynamic, I think.
I remember around the time of 1982, whenever the live album came out, Still Life, I remember seeing an interview with Mick Jagger. And he said that he was a little bit down in the dumps because he just hit 40 and he felt really, really old, you know, considering that's 40 years ago.
Yeah. You know,
so I don't know, maybe he was thinking he was past it at that time, but.
Yeah. Well, Bill Wyman went into the 80s already talking about leaving.
Yes.
So the seeds of that were already there. And, but, you know, anyway, it took him a long time to make it. This album was recorded at Compass Point, Nassau, Bahamas, and then at Pathé Marconi in Paris, and then the Hit Factory in New York. Mm-hmm. And it took a hell of a long time to make it. It was produced by Mick and Keith, featured Ian Stewart, Nicky Hopkins, and Bobby Keys. And famously, many of the tracks that were recorded ended up on the cutting room floor and ended up coming back on Tattoo You. What do you reckon to this album, Richard?
Well, this is the one that I ranked second last in my ranking. I would put this up quite a bit now. I really, really enjoyed this. I don't think it's brilliant. I think there's some, it's like Stone's Light. It's almost like Some Girl's Light. But there's some really good tracks off this, like Emotional Rescue is a wonderful, good, falsetto, almost disco-type song. However, it goes on too long for me. It's much too long. She's So Cold is another great single, which I absolutely love, but it tends to go nowhere. You're expecting a big finale of a finish for it, and it just fades away.
I've got it down as one of the two songs. We should say, actually, viewers, we were going to pick two songs from each record that are our favourites from the record. I forgot to mention that. But I had She's So Cold down as one of my favourites. Now, second to last on the album, it's a strange thing to have a single buried.
Exactly. There's some good stuff off this, but there is some weak tracks like Where the Boys Go. I just think it's silly, and it's almost like a second-rate new wave number. The one I do like is Send It To Me, because there's a bit of a sort of a reggae vibe to it, which I really do like. But my favourite off this, if you want me to say it now, is the opening track, Dance. Wow. I think it's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. It's got a real groove to it. And my second favourite is She's So Cold. So I really enjoyed it. I remember whenever I got into the Stones, I thought this album was okay, but I hated the song Down in the Hole because I am not a big blues fan. And I felt it just was out of place amongst the rest of the album. It's okay now. The worst one is Indian Girl now.
It's interesting that you mentioned the blues because, I mean, one thing that we haven't talked about is this musical tussle that had started to happen between Mick and Keith. And I guess any discussion about 80s Stones, you have to really look at Some Girls as being this very big, successful album, which they had right at the end of the 1970s, really. It was the last album of the 70s. And that was the album where Mick successfully managed to inject the Stones' sound with a bit of disco, a bit of kind of new wave, like American new wave. There was a bit of like American punk kind of sound to it, wasn't there?
Yeah, it shattered and lies and so forth.
Yeah. And I think Emotional Rescue was probably Mick trying to do that again, in a way, trying to keep his ear to the ground, trying to keep that groove-based stuff going, which is where Dance comes from. But I think Keith, at the time, he was really keen on trying to drag the Stones back into the bulrushes of the blues, you know. So that might be why you've got that. You've got the blues on the one hand, but then you've got these more kind of dancey tracks. But, I mean, how would you compare the record to Some Girls?
I'm not a huge fan of Some Girls either, but I would put it on a par. I can understand the appeal of Some Girls. I just think some songs aren't that brilliant. Like, I've never liked the title track, but some of the songs like Beast of Burden and Miss You and Lies are fantastic. But I would put it on a par, but I understand it is a lighter album. It's not quite as strong. Personally, enjoy it every bit as much.
I mean, as far as the critics go, there's this sort of consensus, isn't there, that you've got a great album followed by a not-so-good one, followed by a great one, followed by a not-so-good one. So the standard narrative is Some Girls really good, and then Emotional Rescue not so good, Tattoo You really good, and then Undercover not so good. That seems to be...
Be careful what you say about Undercover.
No, I'm just saying that that's what the critical consensus is. But I agree with you. I don't think this record, I don't think this one is a major disappointment after some gold.
No, that's not.
You know, I enjoy this record, and in some ways I prefer it. My two favourite songs, I'm going to go with She's So Cold, like I said. I actually really like Let Me Go as well on side one.
Yeah.
Let Me Go and She's So Cold. They both seem to connect back in some way to classic 60s Stones. They've both got a kind of really dirty guitar sound, don't they? Really kind of stripped back kind of sound. So let's get into some history now then. So after Emotional Rescue, the big thing that happens is that Jagger refuses to tour. And this is going to start this process now where there's a general dynamic in the band, which is Keith wants to get back on the road all the time and Mick does not. And Keith actually tours with Ron Wood's band, the New Barbarians, around this time. And he sort of, you know, goes off and has a good time and they take loads of drugs. Keith also manages to play his gig in Canada, which was part of his sentence that he got, you know, for the drugs bust. And he doesn't get himself off the drugs. He's still on heroin. He's still carrying on and living this wild life. But he wants to go on tour, and Mick Jagger refuses. And it doesn't get the 80s off to the best start.
Was there a reason for Mick refusing?
I think it's the beginning of the process of Mick. Well, actually, one reason is that Mick was getting very impatient with all the drug abuse that was going on in the band, particularly with Ron Wood. They were getting really pissed off with Ron Wood, because he was constantly off his face and he was just always getting busted all the time. And I think because it used to affect the visas, you know, for actually being able to go abroad and travel. And Ron and Keith, to an extent, were always getting into trouble, and it was making Mick's life a misery, you know, trying to book tours and then realizing that there's all this mountain of legal problems because your guitarists keep getting busted. And I think he was just getting a bit pissed off with it. And he was getting further and further into this world that he'd discovered, I think, you know, during the Some Girls era, which I think Keith would have characterized it as just the gay disco scene, you know, whatever you want to call it, just this club scene, I guess, fashionable club scene, just a world of pop stars and champagne. And it just totally wasn't where Keith was at. Keith wanted to go on the road. Mick Jagger wanted to swan around at parties, being seen and being a big pop star, you know. So the stage is set now, I think, for the basic thrust of all the problems that's going to happen. But Tattoo You, the next record, comes out in August 1981, 24th of August. And the reason that this album got put together, and I say put together rather than recorded, we'll talk about that in a minute, is that they did decide to do a tour in the autumn of 81, and they needed an album, and they couldn't face just recording one. So, I mean, do you want to tell the story? This is quite a well-known story now as to how Tattoo You actually came to be. I mean, it was put together, wasn't it?
It was put together of outtakes. I'm not too sure who suggested they actually record all these outtakes. Was it one of the engineers or...?
It was Chris Kinsey, who worked with him for a long time. He produced Tattoo You. He basically went to Mick and Keith and said, look, if you need an album, I can put one together for you. Now, that wasn't strictly speaking true, because Mick had to do a lot of vocal overdub stuff. Most of the tracks existed as just instrumental cuts. So Mick had to write lyrics. He had to go in and sing songs over these grooves. So just a really quick rundown. You've got Tops and Waiting on a Friend were actually cut for Goat's Head Soup. Slave and Worried About You were from Black and Blue. Start Me Up was a reggae track, which had originally been cut for Some Girls.
Which is now on this.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful.
The double version purchased yesterday will be featured in the next vinyl inbox.
So is the original version of Start Me Up on
there? Yeah, there's a Start Me Up early version, which is on LP2. There's only 9 tracks on LP2, 8 which you'd never heard before. 3 of them are covers, but it's a very good actually.
Black Limousine was also from Some Girls. No More Crying, Neighbours, Heaven and Little TBA were off cuts from Emotional Rescue. And Hang Fire had been worked on during the Some Girl sessions and the Emotional Rescue session. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of stuff floating around, and they pulled it together, and Chris Kimsey twiddled the knobs, and he gave the Stones a much more immediate, big kind of stadium rock sound. I mean, that's one thing about Emotional Rescue is that it doesn't have a big sound. It has more like a sort of club sound again, doesn't it? Whereas
it does, yeah.
I think Tattoo You, it sounds like it's been engineered to sound like a stadium rock.
Correct. Apart from Side 2, Side 2 is weird. on that album because of all the ballads put together.
Yeah.
But it's absolutely fantastic, and it's one of the best sides of any Stones album.
Yeah.
But we'll talk about the tracks shortly.
Yeah, I mean, my two favourites from this album are Waiting on a Friend, which I think is one of my all-time favourite Stones songs, really. I love the saxophone at the end. I just think it's got such a feel-good vibe to it. You know, it's really effortless, wonderful rolling groove to it. But then I also love the second track, Hang Fire, very accessible pop song, I think.
It would be easy for me to pick the two singles, Start Me Up and Waiting on a Friend, but I'm not going to. I'm going to pick Tops, I'm Worried About You, the two openers from side two. Tops has always been a favourite, always has. But recently, Worried About You, I just love the sound of it. I love the sound of the whole of side two. And for me, this is an album of two halves.
Mm.
The first side is okay. Side two, big, big yes. Side one, meh, but it's still not a bad album.
Tattoo You is a massive album. Actually, I didn't mention the chart placings. Emotional Rescue, UK number one, US number one. Tattoo You, UK number two,
yes.
USA number one. So even though there's this perception that Tattoo You was this massive album, in fact, it didn't do as well, really, as Emotional Rescue had done. But it was a huge album, essentially, and it breathed a bit of life back into the Stones' DNA. And then after that, the shit hits the fan. Really complicated story. There's no way I'm going to be able to navigate it totally. Mm-hmm. But essentially, Mick Jagger starts to renegotiate the Stones' distribution deal. They got a distribution deal, I think, with Atlantic, and that had been there for a few years. And Mick goes in to renegotiate it. And while he's doing this, he manages to negotiate for himself a recording contract as a solo artist. And not only does he do that, but he does it behind Keith's back.
Right. Okay.
Doesn't tell him he's doing it. Gets a big advance for a couple of solo albums. And when Keith finds out, obviously he's furious. Particularly as I think one of the Mick solo albums, he decides to record it first, or to at least start writing for it first anyway. He makes it clear that he's going to prioritize it.
Mm-hmm.
And clearly that creates a huge shitstorm, because Keith gets this idea now that Mick is going to try and leave the Stones, essentially. He's going to try and see if he can do it on his own. But despite all this, they do go back into the studio again and they record the album Undercover, again produced by Chris Kimsey, recorded at Pathé Marconi in Paris. And again, it takes a long time to record it. They start recording it in November 82 and it's completed the following summer. So not quite as long as Emotional Rescue, but it's still a fairly lengthy process. A few interesting things about this record. It's the last Stones album released in Ian Stewart's lifetime. So Ian Stewart obviously is the pianist who got sacked from the band early on, but he'd stayed with them. And it's the final album to be distributed by Atlantic. And it features Sly Dunbar and Robbie Shakespeare, the great Jamaican rhythm section. And interestingly with this record, it's a strange thing. Keith had become involved with his new lover, Patty Hansen, and was spending less time with the Stones than usual. He was spending more time with his new girlfriend. So you've got this weird situation where for once it's Keith who's the one who's not quite fully there. And that results in this track being recorded, Too Much Blood, features apparently the Stones roadie Jim Barber on guitar, because Keith wasn't even in the studio that day.
All right. Well, now that you say it, the guitar on this doesn't sound like a Stones guitar. Yeah, this is probably my favourite of the 80s Stones albums.
Interesting.
I absolutely love this. I'm not saying everything on it is perfect, but my least favourite would be Tie You Up, The Pain of Love, the third song on side one, but it's still okay. The rockers on here, I think, are really good. Like, It Must Be Hell and Too Tough. They're beefier. They're more Stonesy. And I think this goes back to more of the Stones of the mid-70s. Almost a little bit Black and Blue in times, but a bit of It's Only Rock and Roll. I think it's great. A wee bit of reggae here with Feel On Baby, which I think is fantastic as well. And even the Pretty Beat Up, which is, I think, mostly a Ron Wood song. Mm-hmm. I think it's just got a great groove to it. So this would be my favourite. My favourite two tracks Undercover of the Night would be in my top 10 Stone singles of all time. So it definitely gets there. And I was thinking about this. I'm actually going to go with the reggae feel on Baby because I enjoy it so much. Good. Fantastic reggae song. And now, this kicks Cherry Old Baby's backside, so it does. It's far better.
I don't think I'm as fond of this record as you are, Richard. Maybe it needs to grow me a bit more. I'm going to be a bit obvious with my choices. I put She Was Hot down, which was the second single. Only got to number 42, but I do like it. I do find it quite an enjoyable song. And this one may surprise you, but I've actually nominated Too Much Blood.
No, I was going to nominate that myself.
Yeah, I find it's got a very nostalgic sound for me, which is odd because I didn't know the song back in the day. Something about the production or the groove of it or something, it takes me back to the 80s in some way. It just makes me fondly remember the 80s. It's just got a great 80s sound to it. I just really like it. And I think, this discussion so far has demonstrated that, there is this kind of school of thought that the Stones are not really worth bothering with. So, I mean, some people say After Some Girls, you might as well just leave it. Mm-hmm. Some people go as far as Tattoo You and then say, you might as well just leave it. But hopefully what we've tried to demonstrate so far, at least, is that, these albums might not be great classics, but they do contain some good material.
They do, without a doubt. They're all, well, most of them do.
Yeah, okay, we'll get to that in a minute. Okay, so a few things happen now. Okay, so after this album, Jagger signs with CBS, all sorts of stuff happens now. He does Dancing in the Street, the single. He does She's the Boss, first solo album, which Keith absolutely hates, thinks it's a complete waste of time.
He's got a writing credit on one of the songs, though.
Oh, does he really?
Yes, the opening track, and it's the most Stonesy type song called Lonely at the Top. But whenever I bought that album back in 85, I thought this is just going to be another Stones album. Mm-hmm. When I played it in preparation for this, I thought I'll give this another go. It is so dated. It's the most dated record of all the Stones catalogue. Although I do really like it. Mm-hmm. It was very contemporary back in the day, back in 1985. But now, Lonely at the Top, although it has a Stones feel to it, very, very dated.
Yeah, well, I guess that's what was going on, really. Mick was starting to properly try and get into the 80s production scene. And he sort of wanted to leave the Stones sound behind him, I guess, to an extent, in order to forge this new career. But I guess one of the big symbols of this gathering or this increasing split is Live Aid in 85.
Yes.
You'd think the Stones would have appeared at that, but instead you had the bizarre spectacle of Mick Jagger performing solo. And then you had Keith and Ronnie making a dreadful appearance with Bob Dylan.
Well, Mick appeared with Tina Turner, I believe, as well, if I can remember. Mm-hmm. So it just goes to show Tina Turner was huge at that time in the pop charts.
Yeah.
So Mick was being more contemporary. Keith was going back to Bob Dylan.
The next album, then.
Right. I'm going to show this because I bought this at the time.
One.
And I peeked through it and I thought there is no way that cellophane is coming off.
Oh.
So that's how the album appeared in red shrink wrap.
So this is dirty work. Okay.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
So you actually get, if you can see that, you get the hype sticker.
Yeah.
So that was bought on the week of release and I looked inside and I thought, no, I'm not taking this off because that's a dreadful, dreadful cover.
Such an 80s. Image now. I mean, they've just totally abandoned all kind of, timeless credibility, and they've just gone for this total kind of 80s overload. So Dirty Work comes off the back of all this stuff that's happening, Mick Jagger, solo album, Live Aid. Comes out on the 24th of March, 86. Sorry, let's just do the Undercover chart stats. Undercover, UK number 3. US number 4. So it's not bad, not bad. Dirty Work comes out 3 years later, UK number 4, US number 4. So they're managing to kind of keep within the top 5 all the time, but they're just not quite able to get to the top. Dirty Work, first album on Columbia, and produced by Steve Lillywhite, who at the time was very, very hot. He'd done the Peter Gabriel Melt album. He'd done Boy by U2. So he was known for this, I guess, a kind of art rock post-punk kind of sound.
He did Simple Minds, Sparkle in the Rain as well.
Sparkle in the Rain, yeah. So you can see probably Mick Jagger was thinking, let's get somebody that can really reinvent us for the late 80s, I guess. Mm-hmm. Now, the problem with this album is that Jagger turns up to the rehearsals with hardly any material. And this is a bit of a first, and this really kicks things off in the studio again, because obviously it had always been the case that, you know, Mick and Keith would arrive for a Stones album with lots of songs all ready to work on, and Mick comes with virtually nothing. And Keith realizes that it's because he's been shuffling all his songs onto his solo albums. So this album, you get the bizarre spectacle of, I think there's only three songs on Dirty Work which are credited to Jagger and Richards. You've got four tracks dedicated to Jagger Richards Wood. You've got one Jagger Richards Chuck Level, and then you've got a couple of cover versions as well. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely a bit of a adulterated Stones album, shall we say. And the sound is not particularly dated well on this record, has it?
No. Especially on the tracks Winning Ugly, and there's another one here, Back to Zero, which are pure mid-80s production.
Yeah.
And there's even slap bass on one of those songs as well. You think you're listening to Level 42.
Yeah, I mean, there were lots of guest musicians on this record. Amazingly, Steve Jordan and Anton Figg on drums. So Charlie isn't even on drums for great swathes of it. Charlie Watts, I mean, you can see him on the cover here. He does not look a happy bunny.
He's not looking happy at all.
And he was addicted to, I think he got himself onto heroin during this period. And he was drinking very heavily and was quite depressed. So this was the period where he did the famous thing where he punched Mick Jagger in the face. You know, the story where Mick Jagger comes in saying, "Where's my drummer?" And Charlie comes upstairs and punches him in the face and says, "You're my singer." Clearly, things not going good with the boys.
It's a bad sign whenever a band of the Stones stature release a cover for their first single from their new album of new material. You know, when was the last time they did that? Must have been, it's all over now, I believe, way back in the 60s. So they obviously weren't confident with the material to be single releases. Mm-hmm. And the second single proved that. I don't even think it managed to hit the top 75.
No.
If it did, it was 71 or 72, one hit to the body. So there's nothing that really stands out on this album for me.
Yeah.
But if I have to pick two songs, I'm going to have to pick Harlem Shuffle, the single. Because it's not bad, but it should never be a Stones single from a new album.
Yeah.
And Sleep Tonight, the Keith Ballard at the end. I picked that as well.
Yeah, I've got that too. I've got that as a favourite. And I've just put the song Dirty Work down.
I was going to pick that because it's half decent.
Half decent, yeah.
Half decent.
But it's certainly not the album it could have been, you know, given they had this kind of star producer. But I guess this schism with Mick and Keith is now so severe. And I think it's when Keith realizes that Mick is trying to groom himself as a kind of solo star. Mm-hmm. Mick goes on tour as well with a band, and they do Stone songs, which is obviously, you know, Keith is just mortified by that. And I guess this is the period now where it really just, you know, the shit hits the fan. They just start to war in the press. Looks like the Stones are going to split.
Yeah.
So it's quite amazing that they actually managed to get it together to do one more record.
To me, this is the start of the 90s Stones.
Yeah.
I think this is really, really sanitized. It's a very, very clean album. There's some very good songs on it, but there's nothing off here that really does sparkle for me either. I think they did better with Voodoo Lounge in 94. It opens up with Sad, 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 which is a good Stones rocker. But unfortunately, they've repeated that sound ever since. And nearly every other album they've released, which is only about four or five, more or less start off with a very, very similar type song. Good live song, because they played it in the 1990 tour. Mixed Emotions was the first single, which didn't do too well over here. I think it got to, if I guess, something like 28 or something, or 24.
It was the last top five single in the US, though.
Yes, it was a big hit in the US, but over here it failed miserably. It's a good enough album, but there's no real sparks on this for me. I believe this got to number two in the UK charts, if I'm correct.
UK number two, and US number three. So this is their 19th album, and it was released on the 29th of August, 1989, and recorded at Air Montserrat, and again produced by Chris Kimsey. Mm-hmm. And it was the record where Keith and Mick basically made up. Somebody got them together, somebody got them on the phone and said, stop being dicks, and got them together. They started writing songs together. And like you say, it laid the groundwork for everything that was going to come after that.
Favourite two songs? Well, first of all, I have to say that the song Hearts for Sale is one of the worst Stones songs on any 80s album. It's dreadful, absolutely dreadful.
Yeah.
My favourite two of this are the best by a long mile is Slipping Away, the Keith ballad, very end. And I also like Continental Drift because it's different.
Yeah.
You know, so I would give it those two.
I actually completely agree with you on that choice. Yeah. I mean, I don't love Continental Drift, but at least it's a bit different, like you say.
It's different and it's interesting.
Breaks the formula. And
yeah, it does.
Slipping Away is a nice track, and in some ways it would have been nice if the Stones had called it a day with that track, because it does sound almost like a curtain call kind of song.
Yeah, it does.
And I mean, so much was going to change after this record. We should just say this is the last album that Bill Wyman played on. And the tour was a huge tour. And I guess it laid the groundwork then for all those big 90s tours. And this may be the most significant record that the Stones have made in the last 30 years, in the sense that if they hadn't have made this one, you know, Dirty Work would have been the swan song record.
Oh dear.
All completely ended in, you know, total disaster. So they were able to pull things back. Now, whether you think that the Stones should have then spent the next 30 years doing what they've been doing, which is essentially just playing massive stadiums.
It's the big corporation, I saw it as, that's all it is.
So just to conclude then, I mean, the Stones in the 80s, it's a mixed story. There's some good records, there's some not so good ones, but I guess it's a crucial decade. They go into the decade, I think, with Mick Jagger deciding that he's going to build this vast Stones empire. And, you know, we were kind of saying at the start how we might explore the fact that despite all the problems, they did actually come out of it stronger than ever in a way. That's as a result of two things. The first thing is that I think Mick Jagger did pull a blinder in the fact that he did get the Stones' business situation totally sorted. He talked to the right people, he negotiated the right deals, he totally blew smoke up the ass of everybody he needed to, you know, in order to just get the Stones as big as they could possibly be. And then you had this thing where Mick and Keith basically learned the hard way that neither of them could actually do it alone. And Mick's albums didn't really sell. Keith made a couple of albums which did better than Mick's albums, but again, you know, they were not big sellers and they were not fantastic albums. They were okay. No. So Mick and Keith, really, at the end of the 80s, they come together and they think to themselves, you know what?
Well, they basically needed each other.
Yeah.
So they needed the Stones to survive, because there's no way Mick was going to survive on his own.
All right, Richard. Well, thank you very much for joining me on this vast odyssey.
And thank you very much for having me. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Excellent. All right, viewers. So let us know what you think. Stones in the 80s. Do rank the albums for us. Tell us your favourite tracks. We'd love to hear your thoughts. And that'll do for now. We'll see you soon. Take care. Bye.
Bye. You'll get me laughing now.
Yeah.
It's shite, this album.